Jenkins, we appreciate you coming here this afternoon to learn about the candidates for the United States House of Representatives and the Kansas House of Representatives. My name is John Schultz. I'm the managing editor of EudoraReporter.com, the news and information website here in Eudora. Assisting me on the stage today is our timekeeper, is Broderick Topol. He is the student council president here at Eudora. We also want to welcome those all watching on the World Wide Web, the Cardinal Online. A big thank you to the Eudora High School Video Department for placing that online today. And appreciate it. Meet the Candidates is sponsored by EudoraReporter.com and the Knights of Columbus Council from Eudora, number 12932. And it's in partnership with the Eudora School District. Now let's introduce the candidates for the 2nd District of Kansas in the United States House of Representatives. First, the Republican candidate, an accountant from Topeka, and 3-term representative for the 2nd District, Congresswoman Lynn Jenkins. Next, he's a school teacher from the Kansas City Campus School District, running as the Libertarian candidate, Mr. Chris Clemmons. And finally, the Democratic candidate, a family law attorney from Lawrence, Ms. Margie Wakefield. Is going to work. First of all, the candidates will have a brief introduction to tell you a little bit about who they are. Following the introductions, each candidate will be asked a series of questions, with candidates rotating first who answers first. The first person to respond will have an opportunity to follow up in rebuttal once the other candidates have answered the question. Following that, the candidates will have an opportunity to sum up and convince you why you should vote for them. Questions I'm about to ask were determined by a panel of editors from EudoraReporter.com with the assistance of the Eudora High School Government Studies class. We ask that if you have any cell phones or mobile devices, they are set silent or turned off for the duration of this event. We also politely request that the audience refrain from any vocal outbursts during this event so the candidates have an opportunity to be heard. Now let's meet the candidates for the United States House of Representatives. We conducted a random drawing for the order of presentation. First up, Libertarian, Chris Clemmons.
How's it going, folks? So they told me I was going to be first, and I figured I should have something important or rather good to say for starting this thing off. As you said, I'm a school teacher. I teach 7th grade physical science at the Kansas City, Kansas School District. A lot of people have been asking me for the last year and a half since I announced I was going to run for Congress here. Why am I doing this? I'm a school teacher. This isn't the type of person that I am. And, my family's been in this state since the 1850s. We've been in the Libertarian area for a long, long time. And I take this candidacy very, very seriously because I know that I'm trying to represent the people of my state. And I've watched, as I've grown up, slowly but surely our constitutional rights being taken away from us every single day. Our Constitution is in shambles. We have our right to protest being taken away from us on a daily basis. We've watched as our government has passed sneaky bits of legislation through things like the NDAA, which has allowed the United States government to indefinitely detain American citizens on suspicion alone. We have sat there and we've watched RICO laws go from addressing organized crime to going and getting small-time drug offenders. If you don't know what RICO laws are, that's where the government basically takes all your assets and freezes them until you can prove that you're innocent. Try paying for a lawyer when you don't have any money, right? So I continually watch this 1984 scenario open up and play out in front of my eyes, and I'm ready to finally take a stand against it. I'm watching as our failed government policies are destroying agriculture in our state. We're losing our water resources, we're losing our soil resources, because of failed policies with our government. So I'm here, and a teacher, I can't say anything in 2 minutes. I'm running to bring a voice of reason to the House of Representatives.
Thank you, Mr. Clemmons. Next up, Representative Jenkins.
First, I'd like to thank our hosts for today and all of you for attending. Washington is gridlocked because people are refusing to sit down and have conversations. Over the past few years in Congress, I've made every effort to put forward the best ideas possible. Solutions on Medicare, on our nation's debt, on rural health care, on the tax code, on mental health, on the cost of college. Solutions I felt would lead to a greater freedom and more opportunity for Americans. And I have always remained open to the best ideas of others, regardless of their political party. Due to that approach, the majority of the legislation that I have introduced this Congress has garnered bipartisan support. There's no doubt that Republicans, Democrats, Libertarians want to make the country better. It's just a difference of philosophy and how we get there. My philosophy is simple. Government is there to create an environment for you to do your jobs, to protect us, and to serve us as a temporary safety net for those needing a hand up. As you listen to today's debate, I would like you to listen for who has solutions. Today, my Democrat opponent has distorted and attacked my record, but the only thing that she has said she's for is Obamacare and the PTC. So I'd like to address those two. Personally, I don't think Obamacare is working, and I have voted to repeal it. But I've also proposed ideas that would get to the heart of the problem, letting patients choose the plans they want, the doctors they need, and the costs they can afford. As for the PTC, I believe it has some usefulness in the short term, which is why I support a short-term extension. But special tax carve-outs like the PTC and too many others are rarely long-term solutions. The reason I ran for Congress is because I was unhappy with both parties. They spent without regard for the future. In Congress, I have slowed the spending and the intrusion of government into our private lives. Now more than ever, Kansans need real solutions to help create jobs, build a healthy economy, and help hardworking families take home more of their pay. I look forward to the discussion of our solutions today.
Thank you, Congresswoman. Finally, Ms. Wakefield.
Well, thank you, John. And I want to thank you, the Eudora Reporter, the Knights of Columbus, and the Eudora School District for hosting us this afternoon. And a special thank you to Eudora Middle School Cardinals for allowing us to use their auditorium for this debate. Also, thank you, Congresswoman Jenkins and Mr. Clemmons, for joining me on stage today. My name is Margie Wakefield, and I'm running to represent you in the United States House of Representatives. I'm running for Congress because I believe that the gridlock and the dysfunction in Washington isn't working for us, and it won't work for our children's future. I've spent 29 years as a family law attorney in Kansas, working to bring divided families with polarized divisions toward workable solutions that are in the best interest of all involved. And that's what we need in Congress, a representative who will reach across entrenched partisan divides to get the job done. Now, if you ask my opponent, Congresswoman Jenkins, what's wrong with Washington, she'll tell you it's the Senate's fault. Certainly, there's a lot of blame to go around in Washington, but she's a leader of the gridlock and the obstruction in Congress, and she's not taking 1 ounce of responsibility for it. No matter how you spin it or who you blame, this is the least productive Congress in our nation's history. We have big problems ahead of us, and we'll need big ideas to solve them. Congresswoman Jenkins is doubling down on more finger pointing, more blame, and more partisan political gains. This is not a game to Kansans. Kansans are fed up with dysfunction in Congress, and they need Congress to work together to get the job done. That's what I'll do in Washington. I'll use my experience to bring people together.
Thank you, Ms. Wakefield.
Thank you.
During the Q&A period, each candidate will have 2 minutes to respond to each question, and the first candidate to answer will have an opportunity for rebuttal. We are keeping time. You have a clock on the monitor in front of you. We do ask the candidates to not interrupt each other during this part of the session so that each has an equal opportunity to answer. Mr. Clemmons, the Affordable Care Act, commonly referred to as Obamacare, has seen multiple changes, revisions, and delays in being implemented. Please state what your plan or strategy is regarding the Affordable Care Act and health care for citizens.
When it comes to the Affordable Care Act, formerly known as Obamacare, there's a lot of issues with it. Both parties can sit there and bicker back and forth and back and forth and back and forth, and we're driving us. With me, it's very simple. This particular policy is unconstitutional. It forces every single American to pay for something that they don't necessarily want. It puts an unnecessary tax burden on every single American family, and it punishes those who can't afford the Obamacare or who choose to opt out, right? So while I would like to stand up here and say that, if we have one more extra vote in the House of Representatives, we can get it repealed. But the Senate and the President are mostly Democratic, there's really no chance of that actually happening. What I would like to focus on is trying to come up with other solutions where we can allow more choice for Americans in their healthcare. Moving off of the healthcare model, so to speak, and moving to a concierge-style service might be a better option for our nation, where you pay a monthly membership fee to your doctor and you get wholesale prices on all medications in the doctor's office. It's been proven to work in several places in our state here, and it's a better option than simply paying outrageous prices for overpriced insurance that generally doesn't like to cover anything that you need, right? So we can come up here, we can argue back and forth as to we voted for this and we voted for this and so on and so forth, but really the conversation needs to change.
Thank you, Mr. Clemmons. Congresswoman Jenkins.
Thank you. The problem with Obamacare is sold to the American people based on lies. If you like what you have, you can keep it. Was lie of the year last year. If you like your doctor, you can keep them. Your premiums were going to go down about $2,500 per family. It wasn't going to increase the debt. All of those were lies, and that's how it was sold to the American people. The main concern, it has done nothing to address the issue that was at hand when the debate began, and that was the affordability of health care, to make it available for every American to be able to afford health care. It's done nothing to drive the cost up. And at the expense of Medicare, over $700 billion in Medicare cuts, thanks to Obamacare, and we still don't have coverage. A bunch of us got kicked off the healthcare we like and forced into the exchange, and we haven't moved the needle on getting coverage. I believe there's a better way. I voted against Obamacare when it originally came to the floor of the House and supported the alternative bill, the motion to recommit, which did a whole lot to move the needle as far as lowering the cost than the 2,800 pages that was Obamacare. It allowed for medical malpractice reforms, for selling health insurance across state lines, to increase competition to drive down the cost, increased health savings accounts. It was a viable alternative that we think would have done a whole lot more to address the issue. This Congress, I have co-sponsored House Bill 3121, which is, again, an alternative on what to do, but I'm probably really concerned about just the pain that the American people are going through after this disastrous rollout, and proud of the 7 bills that we passed that the President signed into law to help take the pressure off the American people, and the other 20 bills that we proposed in the House, that we passed through the House, that he unilaterally decided to implement. So we're getting closer. We got a whole lot more work to do.
Thank you. Ms. Wakefield.
Well, it's clear that we cannot go back to the old system, where we had pre-existing conditions and people were denied care, where there were lifetime caps put on people who had chronic illnesses. Americans were forced into bankruptcy and taxpayers were left picking up the tab for the uninsured. Is it a perfect law? No. But we've got to work together to find constructive solutions. Congresswoman Jenkins has voted over 50 times to repeal the Affordable Care Act. She shut down the government over it for 16 days. She's leading the gridlock and an obstruction on this. She talks about sending bills up that are going to help, but how are those going to help if all they are is more of the same? There's no real effort to to fix the problems. The only thing she's doing is to try to appeal the Affordable Care Act. There are ways that we can help. We could authorize Medicare to negotiate prescription drug prices. We could make sure that when you go in to get a medical procedure, whether it's at a hospital or with your doctor, that you know what it's going to cost. Where else do you buy something and you have no idea what the costs are going to be? Let's make healthcare transparent. Let's make sure that if we are being prescribed medications, that we know if the doctors who are prescribing them are getting kickbacks, money from the pharmaceutical companies. This is only fair. This is what we need to do to fix the healthcare system, not voting again to repeal the Affordable Care Act.
Thank you, Ms. Wakefield. Mr. Clemmons, do you have a rebuttal?
I do have a rebuttal. So here's really what it comes down to. We're addressing it in a backwards fashion. We're talking about healthcare. We're not addressing the cost of healthcare. As Ms. Jenkins said, this was supposed to bring the cost of healthcare down. We're being forced to pay for insurance, which is a backwards approach. What we need to be focused on is shortening medical patents, which keep the cost of healthcare at an inflated price, right? We need to focus on going in and reducing the regulations for clinical research so that medicines, when they finally do hit the shelves, that research and development cost isn't so high and they don't have to charge so much for the care that they're getting. We need to start allowing and getting the government out of the whole process and allowing for more experimental procedures, allowing for other alternative medicines like cannabis, as we've seen, has proved in terms of pain control, et cetera, much, much, much better, cheaper, more affordable, and healthy way to address pain other than the opiates, which cause addiction and so many other problems.
Thank you, sir. Representative Jenkins, the Islamic State terrorist group has risen up in recent months to pose a substantial threat in northern Iraq and Syria. It was just announced on Thursday by the Iraqi Prime Minister that the group may be planning attacks in the United States and Europe. While air and missile strikes in Syria began early last week, it appears the Islamic State may be looking at branching out to U.S. soil. What is your opinion on the United States response, and what should we do going forward?
Well, I think any terrorists that pose a threat to our freedom should not be tolerated. And as of now, the president has not articulated a sound enough strategy for the American people. I'm going to continue to work with my colleagues to push the president and his administration to articulate a comprehensive strategy that clearly articulates plans to eliminate the Islamic State and future threats to our homeland. And I supported the airstrikes launched by the president, but I understand that this is just one step in what must be a larger effort to destroy and defeat this terrorist organization. They can't be ignored. They committed brutal acts of violence on civilian populations. At this point, I think in order for me to support any kind of boots on the ground, our commander-in-chief must articulate a couple things. He must ensure that there's an actual strategy of when, and ensure that this is an issue of national security and an immediate threat to our homeland. We can't ask our men and women in uniform to step into harm's way without support of Congress. And like I said, I've supported the amendment to respond to the president's request to train and equip the vetted Syrian opposition forces. And General Dempsey, the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, called it a necessary but not a sufficient step. And I'm not convinced that this effort alone will destroy ISIL, and I'm concerned that this approach comes with great risk. And that's why I'm pleased that we have added significant oversight to the legislation in the past to ensure program is properly and carefully managed.
Thank you, Congresswoman. Ms. Wakefield.
First of all, let's go back to the prior question quickly. The truth is, and the facts are, is that the Affordable Care Act is bringing the cost of health care down. Ms. Jenkins mentioned that there have been cuts to Medicare that are harming
customers. We're talking about the Islamic State.
Thank you. I'm finishing. That's not true. There are not cuts to Medicare that are causing problems. As to the Islamic State, there is no Islamic State. There is ISIL. And What I am concerned about is what I just heard from the Congresswoman expressing that the president has not gone far enough. I'm wondering if I'm hearing her in favor of boots on the ground. This is a concern. It would be great to know what Congress really thought about it. It would be great if Congress was back in Washington doing their job instead of leaving 2 weeks early. I believe that before we ever take military intervention action, that we have got to ask ourselves three questions. Does it serve our country's best interest? Does it affect our values? Do we believe in it? And does our country have sufficient leverage to make a positive impact at a cost we're willing to pay? These are the questions we've always got to ask before we put our military men and women in harm's way. Right now, the president has started airstrikes. We know we have the best capability to leverage with airstrikes of anybody in the world. Our military is partnering with people in the region, and that's what we need to do. The president has clearly articulated that we must have an inclusive alliance, and that's what's happening. For the first time, the Arab states are involved. That is a clear articulation of policy. If the Congress wants to know more, go back to work.
First and foremost, the recent intervention into this region should have been handled by Congress. Congress is the only body that has the right to declare war. The president cannot unilaterally take military actions against another nation. So what is occurring right now is technically illegal under our Constitution. That sucks. Yes! That sucks. We have been arming this region and training rebels since before I was born, with Al-Qaeda, or what was originally the Mujahideen, with Saddam Hussein, etc., etc. We continue to put weapons and training into the hand of extremists, and it has to stop. We cannot continue to fund moderate forces in other countries and expect that somehow more weapons are going to solve the problem. Year after year, decade after decade, we're in a state of perpetual war because all we want to do is put more weapons in the hands of crazy people, and it has to stop. That's number one. Number two, while ISIS or ISIL or the Islamic State, whatever you want to call them, while they are scary, they are at the most 15,000 young men of about 20 years of age who are very idealistic and, to be honest with you, pose very, very little threat to our own land. If we want to address the situation, we go in, we put forces to contain them within Iraq and allow the Kurds, who have a very strong army, Iran, Saudi Arabia, and the other countries in the region who are supposedly our allies, allow them to handle the situation. People keep talking about how extreme these people are, how they're murdering people in the streets and stuff like that. The only reason they have support right now is because we put a paper regime in that basically ignored the minority people in the government and in the state. There was a power vacuum, and people are supporting ISIS right now to get rid of that regime. As soon as that regime has pushed as far as they can go, the people of this nation, of Iraq, will get fed up with them, and ISIS will deflate on their own.
Thank you, sir. Representative Jenkins, a rebuttal?
Sure. I just want to be clear. Congress stands ready to go back to Washington at a moment's notice if the president can come up with a plan. That's what's the last thing.
I admonish the audience, please, no outburst.
It's a plan. And I think that even was stated by Democrats that they aren't even fully in support of what the president's doing because he has an articulated way to destroy ISIL. So at which point the national security advisors can advise the president and he would like to move forward with coming to Congress with a plan and a resolution, it takes about 2.5 hours for us all to get back in. And I just want to go back, since she used her ISIL time, Ms. Wakefield made the comment that Medicare cuts are not causing a problem, which causes me great concern that someone would be airborne cuts in the Obamacare program, $716 billion, and keep in mind, Medicare is already bankrupt. It is going bankrupt. It will be bankrupt in a dozen years. These are facts. You're entitled to your own opinion, but you're not entitled to your own facts. And so this is a problem. And so further doing damage to Medicare is a real issue for the American people.
Thank you, ma'am. I do want to caution the audience, please, no outbursts so all the candidates can be heard. Ms. Wakefield, the 2nd Congressional District is made up of multiple communities whose economy depends on farming. The House and the Senate passed the Farm Bill in early 2014, updating many key elements, but some farmers say it was not enough. How would you address the needs and challenges of Kansas farmers?
What farmers have told me as I've traveled across the district and talked with them is that they need certainty and stability, like any business person, so they know how to plan. They needed the 2014 Farm Bill, and even though it wasn't perfect for them, they knew that they needed it, and even Farm Bureau was for it. Unfortunately, Congresswoman Jenkins voted against the Farm Bill, and then she voted for the budget that would cut $23 billion in crop insurance. This is the most important thing to farmers, is crop insurance for those disaster times. I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll push to be placed on the House Agriculture Committee when I'm elected to Congress. It's a travesty that Kansas does not have representation on the House Agriculture Committee. We want to give our farmers a voice in Washington, and for too long they haven't had one. They need an advocate. I know that farmers are very concerned about what they see as overreaching regulations. They're concerned about the EPA's interpretation of the Clean Water Act for navigable waters. They want regulations that make common sense to them. So I have listened to them, and I've talked to the EPA, and I've talked to the Department of Agriculture. And what I know is that you've got two sides that aren't talking to each other, that mistrust each other, that reflect that atmosphere in Washington. So when Congresswoman Jenkins jumps in the middle of it and agitates it by saying that the EPA's rules are going to be the biggest land grab in history and that they're trying to regulate puddles on farmers' land, that's just stirring up the bitter partisanship and the bitterness and the mistrust. It doesn't help. We need somebody who will talk to each other and work on this problem.
Thank you, ma'am. Mr. Clemmons.
All right, so this is an incredibly nuanced issue. There's so many different facets of this argument that 2 minutes doesn't really do it justice. So I'm going to try and talk very quickly here. Number one, our state in Nebraska and a few in the western border are in dire straits right now. Our Ogallala aquifer is drying up very, very quickly. Our soil is actually re-desertifying. It means it's turning back into the desert that it was 7,000 years ago. So we're in a situation where our soil resources are getting used up very quickly and our water resources are getting used up very quickly. We have maybe 50 years left of water. After that, agriculture is dead in Kansas and there's nothing we can do about it. Why is this happening? Well, what are we growing in these areas, in this hot, dry environment? We're growing corn, soy, and cotton. Yeah, we're growing cotton here in Kansas. Does that make sense? No, it doesn't. You know why we're doing it? Because there's farm subsidies to grow cotton. There's money to be made there. And while I know it's not always a popular position to take in an agricultural state, farm subsidies are killing our agriculture. We should be growing things like hemp, like wheat, the things that we have been growing in this state for hundreds of years. Corn, soy, et cetera, while they might be money-making crops because of these subsidies, are gonna kill our state. And in 50 years, if you want to see Kansas a dead, barren wasteland, that's what you're going to get if we continue these policies. We have to legalize the growing of hemp because that particular, by the way, just to clarify, hemp is not the psychoactive marijuana that everybody's worried about. Okay? We used to grow hemp in this state. We're actually the nation's leading grower of hemp. It's one of the most useful plants, and right now, because you can't grow it in the United States, It's got one of the highest per acre values of any crop out there. We could revamp Kansas agriculture by legalizing one plant.
Thank you, sir. Congresswoman.
Thank you. Well, if you listen to the attacks of my Democrat opponent on the farm bill, you might wonder why the Kansas Farm Bureau has recently endorsed me in this race. Kansas Farm Bureau is the largest ag organization in Kansas. It's a member-driven organization. It's not that the leadership decides who's going to be endorsed and promoted in these elections. It is member-driven. The ag producers, the farmers and ranchers of Kansas decide. I was recently given the Friend of the Farmer Award. I've received it for the three Congresses that I've served. Not everyone gets that. Only half of the House delegation got it this year, and I was proud to receive that award this year. And you ask yourself why, given the criticism. It's because I understand agriculture. There is nothing she could read, no primer from the Democrat Party that's going to help her understand agriculture, because she hasn't lived it, and I have. I grew up on a dairy farm, milked 100 head of Holstein cattle morning and night. We raised hogs. I sat in a farrowing house in the middle of the night, rescuing baby pigs, wiping their snouts off, putting them under the heating lamp, making sure mama didn't sleep on them or eat them. I cut my little finger off castrating pigs. Sat on the corn box while my dad planted corn because he had a rickety old planter and we couldn't afford anything better to make sure that the corn was planting. You don't learn agriculture by a briefer or listening to the Democrats' complaints. How you learn agriculture is you live it and you breathe it and then you go and fight for it. The reason the farm bill was a disaster was because it didn't address cool. I bet she doesn't even know what that is. Country of origin labeling. Didn't address gypsum, as she doesn't even know what that is. It's the grain inspection for stockmen. These are the issues that are important to the farmers and ranchers of Kansas, and it didn't even address it. She refers to the waters of the U.S. She says she calls the Sierra Club to see what they think about the waters of the U.S. I'll tell you what, I know one thing. The farmers and the ranchers do not need to know what the Sierra Club thinks about how it is affecting their bottom line, and it's not that they're thinking about regulating petals. That is what they're doing.
Ms. Wakefield, your opportunity for rebuttal.
Congresswoman, let me introduce myself. My name is Margie Wakefield, and I've talked to all parties involved in the issue, and that's what needs to happen. That's the difference. I don't need to slop pigs today in order to be able to know how to advocate. That's what we need in Washington, is an advocate for our farmers.
Thank you, ma'am. We've heard the response on some of the major issues of the day from the candidates. Now we want to delve a little bit deeper into why they want to head to Washington, D.C. Mr. Clemmons, please tell us the one thing you would introduce, change, or fix in the United States House of Representatives.
The number one thing. The one thing that really got me interested in running for Congress, as I said in my opening remarks, is our constitutional issues. And I understand that, our nation right now is in some tumultuous times. We're in a recession that has lasted since way before I was in high school, right? So we're all feeling it, and I understand that. But we have to start taking our freedoms seriously. We have to start taking our constitutional liberties seriously. And we can't allow the Democrats and Republicans to sit there and hide what they're doing, trying to promise jobs. Always trying to keep my city in front of you. Jobs. We've got to move right here. Right? We have to really come together and come to a consensus on what's important to our lives. What's more important? Is your freedom, is your constitution, the thing that makes us America more important? Or is the promise of a future job more important? I'm not saying that we can't focus on both, but we have to address the constitutional issues. We have to overturn the Patriot Act, which is allowing the government to spy on every single phone call, every email, every single click on your computer that you've ever made. It's all being stored to be used against you at a later time. There's a reason why our founding fathers made these rights our rights. There's a reason why that Constitution has not been changed since the founding of our nation. It's because every single Congress that has come through until recent understood that that document is what makes our country great. And the number one issue that I'm going to take to Washington is to restore our constitutional liberties.
Thank you, sir. Congresswoman.
The difference between me going in January and these others, too, is I've actually been there, so I want to just review with you some of the things we actually have got accomplished in a bipartisan environment in Washington, because I really think it's important that you all know, despite a divided government, I've been able to keep the NMAV project moving, one of the largest economic engines this area in the country will see for decades. I was successful in working with my Democrat colleague, Ron Barber, and secured money for mental health first aid, which is important to folks like Bert Nash and our communities to help keep us safe. We were able to secure a buyout for the folks in Trees that were having some environmental concerns. We were able to get the Topeka levee in the projects that will be taken up in the near future. We've been able to cut spending 2 years running with the opposition from the administration and the Democrat majority in the Senate. We passed no budget, no pay, which was a significant outcome from our No Labels Problem Solvers Group, which I was an inaugural member of. And if I were to go in January, again, I think my focus, if I had one, which is what the question was, it would be a balanced budget amendment. Our nation is hemorrhaging. Our economy is on the brink. We cannot sustain the kind of deficit spending that we have incurred. And the good news is I actually have supported a plan that balances the budget and gets us to a balanced budget, something I'm certain a Democrat candidate has not proposed or supported, because the president has never sent a budget that balanced, and the Democrat majority doesn't really do a budget ever unless we pass an election of pay, and if they do, it never balances. So that is about balancing the budget and giving people some security and certainty about the environment.
Thank you, ma'am. Ms. Wakefield.
I've been traveling across the district for over a year, and in the last couple of weeks, we live on a three-day tour and went through 21 towns, and I'm listening to Kansans, and what they are telling me is that they are so frustrated with Washington and frustrated with the lack of leadership in Congress. They don't want any more blame. They don't want any more finger pointing. They want somebody who can actually work with people and get things done. During the Congresswoman's 6 years in Congress, she's passed 8 bills out of committee, 5 of which passed out of the House, 0 have become law. Congresswoman is not getting the job done. She's leading the problem in Congress. I have a history. I have worked in my own business for 29 years, and I know what it takes to bring people to the middle, to find the facts and work together for solutions that are the best for all of us, including a balanced budget. You know, we can balance the budget. We've done it before, the last time in the 90s. And we didn't do it by cutting taxes for the millionaires and the billionaires on the backs of the middle class. We did it. The economy and creating jobs. So we got to raise wages that have been stagnant for years. We need to close the gender wage gap. We need to raise the minimum wage. We need to enact responsible immigration reform that will make legal taxpayers into the system. And then we'll balance our budget.
Amen.
You know, we talk about a balanced budget all the time. You know, Lynn Jenkins, I remember her talking to Nancy Pega, and during a debate, and saying that, you know, what better time to send a CPA to Washington? And then I watched her this year go vote for the omnibus spending bill, which cut military pensions and increased the military budget by another $50 billion. It's continued policies of arming, believe it or not, arming people in Africa now. So this is called the new normal. We're out there and we're going to arm every single extremist and radical in the entire world so that we can at some point in time have an excuse to go back in there, put boots on the ground, and put the flames up, right? So, you know, I hear a lot of talk about everybody talking about this balanced budget, but nobody ever really has any real proposals on how to do it. I think I've got quite a few good ideas, so if we get to it tonight.
Thank you.
Oh, thank you, Chair.
Congresswoman Jenkins, very simply, please tell us what makes you want to be involved in the political process.
You know, I ask myself that on a day-to-day basis, and it comes down to our country is a mess. We have $17 trillion in debt. Our debt-to-GDP ratio is unsustainable. When you look at countries like Greece and Portugal, you'll quickly see what is going to happen to our country if somebody doesn't step up and put their finger in the dike. We've got unemployment that remains unbelievably high. We've got a bunch of folks that have just all but given up looking for work. They can't find a job. They've dropped out of the labor force. The cost of college education is skyrocketing. I've got two kids in college. I don't know how people do it. We've got scandals run amok with a big government that has gotten too big and too out of control. An IRS that is targeting Americans based on their political beliefs. We've got the VA that won't even take care of people that have lost limbs and eyesight. Some have given a spouse to protect this country, and we won't take care of them. The problems in this nation have got to stop, and it starts at the federal level. We've got to rein this big government in, get our arms around it, and be responsible and accountable to the American people. And that's what I've been doing the last few years. I don't know where Chris was when he's talking about the balanced budget. I've supported one. We've offered one. We passed it. It's one of the 350 bills that are awaiting action in the Senate. 98% of those bills passed with bipartisan support. 50% of them were unopposed, passed without any opposition. There's work to be done, and I'm determined to go make us a better life for my kids.
Ms. Wakefield.
It's about where we are today. You think about the future, you think about our children. What are we leaving them with? What is our legacy to them? So I decided to jump in this year and to try to make a difference. People are cynical. They don't think maybe that anything can be done in Washington. I decided that as long as we still love this country, as long as we believe in our system of government, and I do, that you have to try. And you have to try one person at a time. And so, let's start with education. We've got to give our tools to the children that they need in order to get ahead in the world. The key to economic growth and for their leadership is education. We've seen the damage in Kansas due to education cuts from Governor Brownback. Congresswoman Jenkins, unfortunately, isn't any different. Her path to prosperity, she calls that, to her vote for the Ryan Republican budget, it included billions in cuts to the K-12 budget, $170 billion to Pell Grants and student loan programs, hundreds of thousands of children kicked out of Head Start. This is not expanding education or opportunities for children. This is what we want in Kansas. This is what Kansans are telling me they need. Congresswoman Jenkins gave us a long laundry list of things that she says are wrong with the country. But for 6 years, she's been part of the problem. And now, she leads that problem as vice chair of the House Republican Caucus. She leads the obstruction agenda that stops Congress from getting anything done. Those bipartisan bills, votes to repeal the Affordable Care Act, votes for the Ryan budget.
Thank you. Mr. Clemmons.
Okay. So, As I said before, you know, I'm a teacher. I just finished up my master's degree. I plan on retiring as a teacher. That's what I want to do with my life. I want to get back to the community. I want to ensure that our country had a bright future. And at some point in time, growing up and going through my American history classes and listening to all of these amazing things that America did, I started to actually pay attention to politics, what was actually going on with what was being told in the classroom. And my head flipped. And just like everybody in this room, I'm sure, I saw these politicians who were bought and paid for by this corporation or that corporation, or this university or that university, or this political action committee or that one. And I said to myself, there's no one out there actually representing the people of my state. There's no one out there who's willing to be a principled person, a principled politician, and actually run for the people of Kansas. Instead, we're out there running for one of the largest payday loan companies in America, and we're passing bills that support this big bank or this big oil company, and nothing ever actually is done to the people in the state. I've watched as the state, the federal government, has grown and grown and grown, and our lives get worse because of it. And last summer, I finally stayed up to midnight one too many times. I finally cried myself to sleep so many for the last time, and I finally said, dang it, I'm going to do something. And that's why I decided to run. Because I'm fed up, just like every single American is in this room, with bought and paid for politicians.
Thank you, sir.
And I think at the end of the day, you know, I think people just want to be assured that somebody's going to go to Washington and put people before the politics. And I'm proud of the record that I have in doing that. I was an inaugural member of the No Labels Organization Problem Solvers Caucus on Capitol Hill, which we started out with a dozen or so of us, half from the Republican Party, half from the Democrat Party, some from the Senate, some from the House. And we have been bridging the gap now for nearly 2 years on finding common ground. That is why we've had success in the House passing legislation over to Harry Reid to get people back to work, to get more money in people's pockets, to get the economy moving. And I'm proud that half of the bills that I've introduced have bipartisan support. But we're not done yet. We still have work to do. I think compromise is part of it, and that's why I was disappointed when I read the Wakefield quote where she said, I'm afraid that due to the compromise that is going to take place in Washington, some things aren't going to happen. That's a very dangerous attitude to
take
to
Washington. Thank you all. We do need to move on to closing remarks. Ms. Wakefield, you were the last to start with opening remarks, so let's begin with you.
We've seen that Congresswoman Jenkins has doubled down on more finger pointing and more partisan political games. We can all agree that there's plenty of blame to go around in Washington, but we also know that for her suggesting that the House is working well together and in a bipartisan way is nothing short of laughable. The dysfunction, obstruction, and gamesmanship in Congress, led by Congresswoman Jenkins, isn't working for us, and it won't work for our future, and no matter how you spin it, this has been the least productive Congress in history. When I'm in Congress, I'll work to provide better opportunities for working families to succeed. I'll bring together business, education, and government leaders to build an environment in our district that attracts good-paying jobs. I'll make commitment to education, ensuring that our students and our teachers have the resources they need to succeed in the classroom. And I'll champion the growth of new industries that are important to the future of Kansas, like wind energy. I've spent 29 years as a family law attorney in Kansas, working to bring divided families toward workable solutions that are in the best interest of all involved. And that's what we need in Congress now, a real representative of the people who will reach across entrenched partisan divides and get the job done. Because we need, we expect, and deserve that from our representative. And that's what I'll do for you in Washington. Thank you very much.
Amen.
Well, unfortunately, today my Democrat opponent chose to attack instead of articulating any solutions to make life better. But like the president, I have come to talk about working with the Republicans. Now, she's never actually done it. From mental health first aid to internet to rural health care initiatives, I have a track record of doing what she wants to do. She's basically campaigning to be a liberal version of me. I come home to campus every weekend and talk to folks at church and my son's football games. Grocery store. Humans aren't interested in the bickering you see on cable news programs. They're interested in results. They're concerned about their family and whether their children will have a quality education. They're uncertain about their health care and whether they'll be able to afford it. They want to know about jobs and if the economy will ever be healthy again. They want to feel empowered. They want to be free. They want a government out of their way. That's exactly what I've been doing in Congress. This election offers a clear choice of two completely different versions for the future. We have Margie Wakefield, a Democrat activist, DNC delegate, who has zero history of bipartisan behavior, says she loves Obamacare, supports tax increases, and is a steadfast advocate for the Obama agenda, or a Kansas farm kid, a CPA, who takes common sense to Washington. I'm working to shrink the size of our government to be more accountable and more efficient, to reform our tax code, so once again, America is the best place in the world to start and grow a business, to achieve energy independence, and ensure our military has the tools they need to protect Americans, to pass legislation that kickstarts our economy, that fosters job creation, and get people the help they need. I'll continue to put people before politics and ensure that all Kansans have the opportunity to succeed.
So we've talked about a lot of different issues, a lot of different things that our country faces today. And, you know, these two-minute segments, while they might address bullet points, they don't actually address the problems. These issues that we've talked about today are far more nuanced than any one of us can stand up here and talk about in a two-minute segment. Which is why I ask every single one of you to go to my website, to contact me. I will not give you a robot email back. I will actually type this up and send it to you. I am here to represent you. And, you know, one of the issues that we didn't get to today, and I'm a little disappointed we didn't, is the $41.3 billion in profit the government made this year off of student loans. That is an issue that our country faces that has to be one of the top 10 one of the top five or one of the top three of every single politician out there, because our college students and our graduates are drowning in debt. I just paid $25,000 for my master's. That's something I probably will not pay off in my lifetime on a teacher's salary. And that is how hundreds and thousands of citizens in this country are going to live the rest of their lives as wage slaves, trying to pay off the debt that they took on try and make a better future for themselves. And I haven't heard a single solution in Washington to take care of this. We are profiting off of our students, and that is fundamentally wrong. I think everyone in this room can agree. Now, that's my reason to stand up against people on both sides of me who are bought by PACs, large money donors, and corporations. I pledge to never take a single dime from any of them, and I will continue to run a campaign with that principle in mind. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. How about a round of applause for all three candidates for being here today? We really appreciate you taking the time to debate. We do want to remind you that election day is Tuesday, November 4th. Polls will be open from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. Voter registration closes on October 15th, and advance balloting will begin the next day on the 15th. Remember that Kansas law requires you to present a photo ID to be able to vote. If you do not have a photo ID, you can contact your county clerk's office, your county clerk's office to obtain one. We want to thank the members of the Knights of Columbus, Eudora Council, and the staff of the Eudora Reporter.com for their hospitality. We also want to quickly thank the staff of the Eudora School District, and particularly the Eudora Middle School. We put a lot of time and effort into this We're going to take about a 10-minute break, and we're going to set off for the 42nd House District candidates. So we've got more to come. Please stick around. Thank you for coming this afternoon.